The lecture today about gradient-based learning should give you some idea what gradients are and how we can use them to tune the weights and the bias terms, in general, the parameters of an artificial neural network. So what are the three main components of deep learning? Any ideas? What are three main components of machine learning, and in particular of deep learning? Yes, data model loss. So we have some data points that are characterized by features and labels. Features is what we can measure easily. Doesn't need a lot of intelligence. To find out the labels, typically needs intelligence, and artificial intelligence, like machine learning methods, they try to find out the labels. And they do this by fitting a model to data. And how do we represent the model in deep learning? Deep learning will represent the model by a graphical structure, which is called artificial neural network. And this artificial neural network comes with parameters that we tune such that we find a mapping from the input, from the features to the output, such that the output is a good prediction or approximation of the label. And to make this a sensible approach, we need to measure how good a prediction is. We need a loss. Yeah, by the way, what is the loss function used in deep learning? What is the unique choice of loss function in deep learning? Is there a unique choice for the loss function that we can use to tune the model parameters or the network parameters? There's one comment, stochastic gradient descent. No, stochastic gradient descent is a specific instance of a gradient-based learning method. And there's another comment, ReLU, sigmoid, softmax, these are all activation functions. So these are parameters of the model, of the neural network. But what about the loss function? Which loss function do we always use, or do we always use the same loss function when we train a neural network? Well, the answer is no. You can use any loss function that you wish. Deep learning methods only restrict the models. So only the model, the type of functions from the input, from the features to the predicted label. This is what deep learning fixes. But the loss function can be basically anything. Could be squared error loss, could be logistic loss or cross entropy loss, or what you can also define a custom made loss. There are ways to, or machine learning or deep learning libraries and methods that allow you to specify the loss function. So for each possible pair of predicted label value and true label value, you can specify how much loss this would be for you in the end. And this allows you, for example, to take into account nonlinear behavior of labels. So if you are off the true label by one, might be a different loss. You might want to have a different loss if the true label value is 10 million, or if you're off by one, if the true label value is 0.001. So you might have then a nonlinear behavior of the loss in some sense. And you can use basically any loss function. In Keras, which we use mostly in this course, the Keras library, you have a few pre-specified loss functions like the squared error loss or the cross entropy loss. And the loss function also defines if you use a deep learning for regression or classification. So for regression problems, you typically use a squared error loss, but for classification problems, the squared error loss is not so good. And you might want to use, for example, the cross entropy loss. So the loss is more related to what type of problem you're looking at. Do you want to apply deep learning to a regression problem, or do you want to apply deep learning to a classification problem or a multi-label or a multi-class problem? This characteristic of the problem they influence the choice of loss function. But in principle, you can choose between different, many different loss functions. It's a design choice. And it turns out that the choice of the loss function has also an impact on the ability to implement this program, this deep learning program. That is, the loss function or the type of loss function influences the difficulty, the computational difficulty in tuning the parameters in order to find the parameters that have minimum loss. Okay, so again, deep learning are machine learning methods that use this signal flow structures that we call artificial neural network to represent a map. A map or a hypothesis that reads in the features of a data point, in this case, three features, and outputs a prediction for the label. In this case, the label consists of three individual labels. So this is what we would call, is this a binary classification problem? How do we call such machine learning problems where the data points have several individual labels? Where the data points have multiple labels? How do we refer to such machine learning problems? Exactly, multi-label classification problem. If we would only have one output neuron here, then it would be could be a binary classification problem or a multi-class classification problem. But if we have several neurons, that this hints at a multi-label classification problem. Okay, so the name of the game in deep learning in the end is then to tune the parameters. So we have two types. We might distinguish between two types of parameters. The one type of parameter is the weight that we assign or associate with each link between an output of a neuron and an input of the follow-up neuron. So each of these links of these arrows here is associated a number, which we call the weight of the link. And moreover, we have bias terms that kind of shift the activation function here in this artificial neuron. So we have the weights for the links and the bias terms, but with a slight abuse of notation, because it's convenient, I just call everything weight. So also the bias terms in my language are, or my notation are just weights. And we stack all the weights into a long, very long weight vector. We could also call this weight vector parameter vector, but somehow I like the term weight vector more. And yeah, the goal then is to find the optimal choice for this weight vector. And this is difficult. Why is this difficult? Because this weight vector is long, very long. How many of such parameters do you think do we have nowadays in typical artificial neural networks? Is it 10? Is it 100? Is it 1,000? Millions. Millions is even on the lower end. So nowadays, billions. Billions. We use artificial neural networks nowadays routinely with billions of parameters. So you have to optimize the weight vector with the length of a billion, which is an incredibly difficult problem. So mathematically, but the concept is quite simple. So we look at the loss or the average loss that we get on a training set. So we have some data points for which we know the label, so we can compare the output of the neural network with the true label. And we then compute the loss and average it over the training set. So we do this for every possible weight. Theoretically, we do it. In practice, we can never try it out for all possible weights. So in practice, we don't know this function completely. It's just here, it's a sketch. In principle, there is a function, an objective function whose value for a given weight vector is the average loss or training error that we would get if we use an artificial neural network with dead weights. But in practice, you can never trace it out. You can never probe this function at all possible points because there are too many of these points of possible weight vectors. However, in deep learning, the ultimate goal is to find the optimum. So we would like to find the minimum. So is this really the case? Is the ultimate goal, do you think, is it reasonable to tune the weight vectors extremely accurate to really find the perfect global minimum, the exact global minimum of this objective function? Let's say the objective function is the average loss on the training set that we get from this artificial neural network. Do you think it's reasonable to really use all our guns, all our optimization theory methods to find really the precise optimum of this objective function? Or is it maybe not so important or relevant, the minimum of this objective function? Exactly, very good comment. Because it's not so important to find the perfect, the precise minimum here, because what we minimize here is not actually the actual objective function that we are interested in. In the end, we are interested in learning a predictor that does well on any data point, even the data points outside the training set. And this average loss on the training set is just think of it as an estimation or an approximation of this general performance. And if this approximation is bad, and it can be bad, how do we call such a situation when this training error is a bad approximation for the general error of a hypothesis? How is this bad situation called? One of the most negative words in machine learning, overfitting. Yes, when overfitting happens, this is when this average loss on the training set, this objective function is completely different or doesn't tell us anything about the general performance. In particular, the weight vector that achieves a very small training error or zero training error might have a very large error on other data points outside the training set. So in general, we are not so much interested in finding the precise minimum, but just close enough. And this sets machine learning apart from, I would say, from generic optimization methods and theory. We are not really interested in learning the minimum of the training function, of the training error, but we want to learn the minimum of the function that is approximated by the training error. Okay. But let's say for the time being, we have enough training data, so we do not overfit. By the way, how much training data would we need if we want to train a neural network with billions of parameters? Ten times more, so 10 times of billions of training points. So it's a bit unlikely, but for the sake of this lecture, let's assume we have enough training data. In practice, you will rarely have enough training data to train a neural network from scratch. And we will discuss in round four, is it round four or five, methods, transfer learning methods to cope with this training data. But let's assume we have now, for this lecture, we assume we have enough and focus on the problem of finding a good approximation of this minimum. So here, this was maybe the simplest case with one single weight, because then I can draw a curve. But in typical, we have billions of weights, but I cannot easily represent this loss function as a function of billions of weights. So what I can do, what I can offer you, is also a picture for two weights. Okay, it's also a bit theoretical, I would say, compared to billions of weights. But for two weights, we can represent the cost function by this contour line. So each point on this ellipsis here represents a weight vector which has the same results in the same training error. So all the points on this result in training error 10. All the points on this ellipse result in training error 100. And then there's a sweet spot here, which is the minimum training error. So this is the optimum. And we would like, when we train a neural network, we would like to find weights that are good or close enough to this optimum. And gradient descent is maybe one of the most basic and most powerful and most widely used methods to find such an optimum or approximate such an optimum. I cannot advertise and praise gradient descent enough, because it's such a simple idea and so powerful and so practical. Okay, so what is the basic idea of gradient-based learning? The idea is to approximate this objective function. So remember, this objective function is the training error that we get from the artificial neural network when we use the weights W. Okay, this is a function. Each weight vector is assigned a number, so we get a function. And the goal now is to find this minimum or a good approximation of this minimum. So what could we do? Well, we could say we look, we start with a given choice for the weight. So we might initially use randomly chosen weights or all weight zero. It's just an initialization. And then we say, how can we know to improve this current choice for the weights? Well, we could explore this loss function locally around this current guess. And here's where gradients come into play. It turns out, and here the beauty of analysis of mathematics kicks in, we can pretty much precise or pretty well approximate such a curve, if it's not too wild, if it's smooth enough, by a linear function, and the gradient precisely defines this linear function. It's called the tangent. So this tangent is a linear curve that locally approximates this loss function around a point. So the important word here is locally. In general, this tangent is a linear curve. So it's not a good approximation for this curve for all possible wave vectors, but locally in a sufficient small neighborhood, it does a good job in approximating the loss function. And the nice thing about these linear functions is we pretty much know how to improve the or how to move to decrease the value of a linear function. We just move in the opposite direction as the gradient. So the gradient here is the parameter of this linear function. You can write down the normal vector of this tangent using the gradient. So this is just a more fancy way to express that the fact that this tangent is fully determined by the gradient. Okay, and once you know the tangent, okay, go downwards this tangent. And how do you go downwards? Well, you try to make this expression as negative as possible. And this you can do, you can show that the most negative you can make this, if you constrain the step size, if you constrain by how much you want to change the weight vector, you make it as negative as possible by choosing the update to be minus gradient of this function at this point. Yeah, please don't hesitate to ask questions on the chat, in particular those who are new to this concept of gradients and gradient descent. But you can also read more in chapter 5 of my book, as I have pointed out here. Okay, so is there anything unclear? I would say this is the most important slide of today's talk and maybe also the most important slide for learning methods for gradient-based learning in deep learning. Once you have understood this basic principle, you have a good intuition how these super cool deep learning algorithms train their networks. It's basically a variant, more or less minor modification of this principle. So approximate the objective function, which is the training error as a function of the weights, locally by a tangent, by a linear curve, using the gradient, and then go down, use this local approximation to minimize this local approximation instead of the original function. However, this must not be taken literally because this, as I said, this approximation is local in the sense that it only is a valid approximation locally. So you should only minimize this approximation in a neighborhood. And this corresponds to the choice of a step size. So here's the basic, I would say that the atom of any gradient learning method, the atom, like the artificial neuron is the atom of any artificial neural network. All the gradient based methods have an atom update, which is a gradient step or a gradient descent step. So you have the current guess for the weight vectors in the beginning. If k is here an iteration counter, this might be all zero or set to random numbers. You take the current guess and then you update it. You update it by going into the negative gradient direction, but not really to optimize this approximation, this linear curve, but only for some step size. So does any one of you know If we would not restrict this update to be local, what would we end up with? What would be the optimal weight vector that minimizes this linear function? Well, we could go down indefinitely, infinitely far away. If we don't, in any sense, limit the weight vectors or the range of the weight vectors, this can be small without lower bound. So it's basically meaningless to optimize this local approximation in a global sense. We only should do it locally, and this is what the step size ensures us. So in gradient-based learning, we need to choose a step size, and actually finding good values for the step size is one of the key challenges, which I will now explain in a second. But the second challenge in this gradient-based learning, or in this atomic gradient descent step, is to compute the gradient. I will also tell you why this is in a second, but first let's look at the effect of the step size. So if the step size is too small, we make only very little progress. We only update the weights by very small amounts towards the optimal. So the optimal would be here. Here would be the sweet spot for the weights. Okay, but we make a very slow progress. So if the step size is too small, it takes forever. We would take too many gradient steps. So if, on the other hand, the other extreme, alpha, the step size too large, what could happen? That we overshoot in a certain meaning, and we would start, for example, here, and instead of going towards the minimum, we overshoot and increase the objective value. So this is also too bad. So alpha too large and alpha too small is bad. And also from this picture, it's somewhat reasonable to interpret the step size as a learning rate, because the act of learning, or we could interpret learning as the progress that we make in the weights, in updating the weights towards the optimal weights. So learning means approaching the optimal weights. And the faster we approach these optimal weights, like here, the higher the learning rate. So that's why we basically always mostly refer to the step size of gradient method as learning rate. So the larger the step size, the higher the amount of learning per iteration. However, this interpretation is a bit tricky, because this interpretation breaks down if the step size is too large, because we could then say, okay, so if the learning rate becomes higher when the step size gets higher, so let's make the step size as large as we can. However, you cannot make it arbitrarily large, because then you would basically forget. You would learn in the negative sense. So you would forget to learn when alpha is too large. So this interpretation of the step size as a learning rate only works if the alpha is sufficiently small, or put differently, if alpha is not too large. Okay, so choosing a good step size is very difficult in general, or choosing an optimal step size in a certain sense is highly challenging. But then the other challenge of this basic gradient step is to compute the gradient. You see in the notebook for this round, which includes now also the new coding assignments, by the way, there's an example where we write out, or we work out the gradient in closed form for a squared error loss and linear maps. So for deep neural networks, which are nonlinear, this would look more complicated. So we would have, in particular, partial derivatives with respect to all weights in the network. So does any one of you know the name of an algorithm that is used in deep learning to efficiently compute the gradient? This is one of the buzzwords that always come in, or often come in the context of deep learning. Backpropagation, exactly. So backpropagation is just an efficient method, highly efficient method, to compute this gradient for large artificial neural networks. But it's not more than that. So backpropagation is just a way to compute the gradients, but then you also need to use the gradient for doing an update, and there are different ways to do this. So it's not even a full learning algorithm. It's just the step that computes the gradient, and this is called backpropagation. Okay, but even without the additional challenges that come with nonlinear functions, like in artificial neural networks, also for this linear case, so where we have linear maps, so this here, this would be the function from input to output for a weight vector. So this is a linear map. However, in deep learning, this map looks much more difficult and is represented by the artificial neural network. But for a linear map, we can write it down in closed form, and we can also take the derivatives, the partial derivatives of this function with respect to the individual weights. And yeah, by the way, these partial derivatives are exactly these factors here in front, these gradients. And this changes then when we use deep neural networks, this factor in front. It includes more derivatives and more complicated terms involving these partial derivatives, as a side note. There's one question, is the gradient calculated for all weights at once? So as I write it down here, yeah, so this gradient includes all the partial derivatives of this function with respect to all weights. So, and in artificial neural networks, these weights are all the weights for all links and the bias terms. Yes, we have to compute these gradients all at once. And this backpropagation is very clever in how to compute all these partial derivatives all at once. It does by, in some sense, recycling parts of the computation. So for some partial derivatives, you can reuse earlier partial derivatives or other partial derivatives. But we will not go into any more detail about backpropagation. If you're interested in this, there's a course, more advanced course called Deep Learning starting in January, I think. Okay. So, but even for this case, computing the gradient can be difficult because this M here, the size of the data set or the number of data points can be billions, could be billions. Think of a large database. And also these labels and feature vectors of the data points. So the feature vectors could be large. So each image could be a 1,000 by 1,000 pixel image. And if we stack these pixel values into a vector, we have vectors of length 10 to the power of 6. And also these images could be stored in the cloud, that is all over the world, on computers that are distributed all over the world. And for one single gradient step, typically we need to do many of these gradient steps. So we need to evaluate this gradient often. We would have to gather billions of data points, billions of high dimensional data points from storage, distributed storage. So this would cause a lot of traffic load on the internet. And here comes in a key idea of deep learning and in general of machine learning, to use randomness to approximate complicated things or complicated or challenging computations. So the idea is of stochastic gradient descent, instead of computing a full, the exact gradient over all data points, just use a random subset. And the subset is called a batch. So this batch S, calligraphic S, is a randomly chosen subset of all data points. And we compute the gradient over this subset instead of the complete data set. And it turns out that what we get is a noisy approximation of the gradient. So this quantity here approximates the gradient. It doesn't perfectly approximate it, but it approximates it well enough. Well enough for our purposes, because remember, in machine learning, we are not really interested in finding exactly the minimum, but we are just interested in finding a good enough approximation to the minimum. So if we are in a neighborhood, then we're already happy. We don't need exactly the minimum. And this is what these noisy approximations can still provide. So to quickly converge to a good enough approximation of the optimum. Okay. Yes, so since this estimates here, so this is what we compute, these are gradient estimates that we compute over batch S. Since these are noisy estimates, if we are in some applications, we might be interested really in a high precision approximation to the optimal. So we really want to find the optimum of the training error. Let's say if we for sure not overfitting and have really a lot of training data, then we might be interested in really pushing the limits, pushing to the limits and really find an optimal weight vector. And in this case, we need to somehow iron out or attenuate the gradient noise. And one way to achieve this attenuation of the gradient noise, so to flatten out these random variations in each step, is to use a step size or learning rate that decreases with iterations. So K here is the iteration number. And here, for example, we use the step size in each iteration to be 1/k. So does any one of you have a bad feeling when we use a diminishing step size? What could be a drawback of this when we make the step size smaller and smaller? Well, we could just have too slow progress. So in general, we don't want to make this step size too small, because this would mean we're making slower and slower and slower progress. However, if you use stochastic gradient descent, that is, if you use noisy estimates of the gradient and really want to find at some point the optimal weight vector, you need to slow down. You need to slow down if you use randomness. On the other hand, if and in many applications, you're not really interested in finding the perfect optimum, but you just want to get quickly close enough, then you might not need this diminishing step size. You might use a fixed step size. There are also applications that use fixed step size with stochastic gradient descent. However, theoretically, if you want to reach the perfect optimum and use stochastic gradient descent, you need to reduce the learning rate. Otherwise, you can never smooth out the gradient noise. Okay, yeah. And we call this dependence of the step size on the number of iterations is referred to as learning rate schedule. And this is also can be considered as a hyperparameter of the training algorithm. So you can choose between different such schedules like polynomial, or there's also learning rate schedules that decay exponentially fast as iterations increase. And you can choose between different. And in the end, it's a learning parameter. I don't know of a really useful theory that allows to tell, okay, for this type of data with this statistical properties, use 1/ iteration number to the power of 2 as a learning rate schedule. I don't know about any such really useful theory that applies widely. In the end, it's a matter of trial and error. Okay. Here's a nice overview that Chamsi provided for the notebook. So compared to regular or plain gradient descent, which is also might be called batch gradient descent, where we read in the full data set for each gradient step, mini batch gradient descent makes the big data set. Okay, in this case, it's 50 data points, but think about 10 billion data points. And we make this into small chunks or batches, each of size 10. So this is way more digestible. We only have to read in 10 data points in each gradient step instead of 10 billions from all over the world. So this mini batch gradient descent is basically the only way to go in big data applications. You don't have enough time to do a full gradient computation, and also not enough time and resources in general, when the training data is in the cloud, available in the cloud. When you have all the training data on your own computer and you have a really good computer with powerful hardware, then you might do batch gradient descent. But I would say in most standard applications of deep learning, the training data is not on your computer, but somewhere on a server that is connected over a communication link. So you cannot read in billions of data points easily in each gradient step, unless the gradient step takes forever. So I would say mini batch gradient descent is the default operation nowadays in deep learning. Okay, so this brings me also already to the, there's one question, does the step here like layer? I don't understand the question. No, this is not, in this picture, this is not meant as a layer. So this is not a multi-layer network. What is step? Or step? Yeah, step here means you compute. I should have written this out. A step means you compute this estimate over a batch, and then you use this gradient estimate to update the weight vector. So you do a new weight vector, k plus one, is the current weight vector or guess for the optimal weight vector minus alpha times g of k. So instead of the gradient here, you use the approximation of the gradient. So this is what we mean by one step. Let me know if this answers your question. Okay. Yeah, please don't hold back any other questions. I will collect them at times and try to answer them. So for the final part, I want to discuss a few variants of this basic gradient and stochastic gradient descent, which are based on a simple but important idea. So far in our discussion, we basically used always the gradient at the current guess to locally approximate the cost function or the objective. However, we throw away a lot of information because we throw away the information that we have from an earlier. So let's say we have here the previous iteration was here. So r minus one. And here we also used the local linear approximation and ended up here. So in gradient descent and stochastic gradient descent, we throw away, we forget all the information that was contained in this local approximation. However, we should, or we could, and often we should exploit and take advantage of the information that is carried in the previous iterates. And this is exactly the idea of advanced gradient-based methods. So they use the gradients of previous iterations to construct a better local approximation, which is better than just using the gradient and approximating the function by a tangent. We could, for example, use the tangent at the penultimate iteration or at the previous iteration at the current iteration to fit in a parabola and say, okay, we use this as our approximation. And then minimize this local approximation, this new local approximation locally. Moreover, yeah, so this improved local approximation can be used in two ways at least. So first we can maybe find a better choice for the step size by using this better local approximation. And the second potential use of this improved local approximation is to find a better direction. So to not go always into the negative of the gradient, but to go in a slightly different direction. And I will show you in a second why this might be a good idea. Let me first take a question here. The question is, apart from the schedula, is the step size also determined by the magnitude of the gradient? Larger directions is bigger step. Yes. So the actual step size or the actual amount by which the weight vector is updated is determined by two things. It's determined by the step size and by the gradient. So if the gradient is large for a given fixed step size, also the update will be large because this is the product. Yes. And in general, the step size must be chosen such that this product doesn't escalate, that we don't have overshooting. So we somehow need a bound on how large can this gradient be. And these bounds are often made, they are called Lipschitz, it's called a smoothness assumption. Smoothness assumption. which is that the gradient, norm of gradient, cannot be too large. And then this this upper bound on the gradient can be used to find a good step size, or at least an upper bound on the tolerable step size. Yes, but this is beyond the scope of this course. So we will not discuss a theoretic study of the range of step size parameters that ensure convergence. In the end, it's a matter of trial and error. So you just look at the objective values and hope, or you see if they go down, or if they increase, then you know your alpha is too large. If the progress is too small or too slow, you know alpha is too small, and then you try to tune the step size parameter. Okay. Yes. So advanced methods use the information from previous steps to improve or to adapt, for example, the learning rate. So if you look at the previous iterations and you see you are very slow, then use this information to increase the learning rate. Or if you see from the previous iterations that the objective value increases, so you're overshooting, decrease the learning rate. And this very simple recipe is implemented in different algorithms. Some of them are called RMS prop, Adam, Adagrad. These are all based on this idea to use the previous iterations to build better local approximations and use this local approximation, for example, to get almost a perfect estimate already of the objective function. And when you know the objective function, so to say, you know the ideal step size, you would take one step exactly to the optimum. But this is rarely the case. So typically you can only build a better local approximation, but this better local approximation can also already tell you that you can safely increase the learning rate because it's going down for sure until here. So you can jump at least until here instead of going this micro steps. So this was a bad example because it's not going down until here. So, but at least let's say you can go down until here. Yeah. So these better local approximations can be used not only to adapt the step size, but also to adapt the directions, because as it turns out, the gradient is the best, in some sense, the best local approximation. But we are not interested in having the best local approximation. We, in the end, we are interested in getting close enough, fast, close enough to the optimum. And when you look at the cost function, whose contour plot looks like this. So the cost function is constant here. Let's say here the cost function would be 100. And for this other contour line, it would be 10. So it's constant along this ellipsis. And here's the optimal weight. So when you look at the gradient at the current guess, let's say this is the current guess is here. We start with an initialization for the weights here. Then the gradient looks in this direction, which is actually only a bit going a bit toward, directing a bit to the towards the optimum, but much, much more orthogonal to the optimum. So we would roam around, we make a big detour if we follow the gradient. However, if you combine this gradient, let's say you come from here, this is the previous step. This is the previous step, and you have used here the gradient to come here. And then these advanced gradient-based methods, they combine this gradient, this one here, and this gradient to, for example, fit an ellipse. And when they fit this ellipse and use this ellipse as an approximation to the cost function, and this ellipse might be already a very good approximation to this actual level curves of the cost function, and they can be used to tell, okay, you shouldn't go here the gradient again because you already did the gradient in the other direction. So it seems to be a highly skewed ellipse. So go a bit more in this direction, push it a bit more in this direction. And then we obtain here this adapted direction, which is much, much more making progress much, much more towards the optimum and less into some orthogonal or perpendicular direction. which gradient descent would do. So we can use this previous iterate, this previous the gradients at the previous iterates to build better local approximation, and use this local approximation to come up with a better or adapted direction, which is slightly different from the gradient. And this is done, for example, in this RMS prop or add-in. Yeah, but in the end, I cannot offer you a really useful theory. And in my opinion, a good theory should be useful because theory are our tools. But I don't know a good theory that would allow you to tell which of these variants you should pick for a given data set with given statistical properties. So in the end, it's a hyperparameter, the choice of this optimization algorithm of this variant of gradient descent is a hyperparameter, and you try out different choices and pick the one which has, for example, the smallest validation error. Okay, that's all what I have about gradient-based learning. Please, are there any questions? There's one question, how AutoML chooses the best method? I don't know what you mean with AutoML. There is no general automatic machine learning there yet, but do you refer to a specific software? Yeah, in general, I don't know. AutoML is not solved yet, at least as far as I know. AutoKeras, I guess AutoKeras, I would need to look up the specification, but I guess it tries out, it does as I now explained. So it chooses between a few well-known methods, optimizers, and picks the one which has smallest validation error. But yeah, I have not used AutoKeras yet, so I'm not an expert on this. Does anyone else have used already AutoKeras and could comment on this question, how AutoKeras chooses the best optimizer? Yeah, so I think fully automated machine learning is still open. And if you would solve it, I guess you would be well off for the rest of your life. Okay. Yes, so thanks a lot for your attention, and please start to have a look at the coding assignment for round two on gradient methods, and do not hesitate to ask questions on Slack or by email. Yes, so, okay, here's one last question. What is the role of the initial guess? How can one avoid local minima? So the initial guess is either randomly or you start by all zeros. And again, I don't know of a really widely applicable theory that allows to tell you, given this data set, given a certain data set with certain probabilistic properties or statistical properties like covariance matrix properties, what is the best choice for initialization? I don't know. So you would maybe try out different initializations and view the initialization also as a hyperparameter. However, one way to choose an initialization is very widely used in transfer learning, where you use as an initial guess the weights that you have obtained from training a neural network on a slightly different but related data set. So if you want to build a detector for a specific type of car, let's say you want to build a detector for Teslas, then you might use for your network, you might use as the initialization the network weights that have been obtained by training a network to detect cars. So this is kind of a first step or a pre-step, a prerequisite task for detecting Teslas would be to detect cars. So, and for detecting cars, you might have way more data points. So you could more easily train a network for this car data set, and you use then this pre-trained network or these weights that you got from training on the car data set as the initialization for starting a new training using gradient descent for a Tesla data set, and you might have way less data points. So it's more important for this Tesla data set to have a good initialization. And this initialization might come from training the network on a different, on a related but different and larger data set. Okay, another question. If we choose a very small batch size, can we quickly check all these gradient descent methods in short time? Are these methods difficult to run on our local machine? Yeah, regarding these details, I cannot tell you much. I would highly encourage you to try it out. What are the limits on your own machine when you, particularly when you don't have a graphic processing unit, a GPU, how large the batch size can be? I cannot give you precise information about that. Well, so to decide if one optimization algorithm is better than the other, I mean, if the processing time, how long it takes to learn the method is not, or to run this optimization algorithm is not the main concern, you might just try out different optimizers and pick the one which results in the smallest validation error. But there might be constraints because, for example, the more fancier RMS prop might take too long or might need too much storage. They also have different storage requirements for training the network. So there might be constraints from your local machine, from your desktop computer. But in general, I would try out different optimizers, find weights for the network, and try out the network with these found weights on a validation set, and then pick the optimizer which resulted in the smallest validation error. There's a lot of trial and error still to do in deep learning, unfortunately. There's not much, there's some theoretical guidance, some theoretical tools, but in the end, it's to a good share still trial and error, what the deep learning engineer does. Okay, yes, so if you have any further questions, please ask on the Slack discussion forum or ping me by email. Thanks a lot, everybody, and have a nice week ahead. Bye.